preparedness is the key for an organization and individual staff members to deal effectively with threats. And that's especially important with threats from infectious diseases that could spread and cause harm if not well managed and contained. We've seen this from the coronavirus or SARS. We've seen this from the Middle Eastern Respiratory Syndrome or MERS. And we've seen this with novel forms of flu such as H1N1. And in all of those cases, preparedness is the key to containing and mitigating these threats. Because with containment and preparedness, we can reduce the harm to our patients, to our staff, and to our organizations. We are now facing another threat, a threat from Ebola. And just like the past, preparedness is the key. There's a number of modules, and we hope you find them beneficial and useful on your journey to make sure that you can provide safe care for your patients.
In the first module, we will outline considerations for preparedness planning for acute care facilities who provide emergency care services. The second module will discuss how to screen and identify patients who may have risk factors for or symptoms of Ebola virus disease. In the third module, we will outline how to safely isolate patients who are under investigation for Ebola. And in the fourth and final module, how to evaluate and briefly manage these patients. On behalf of my colleagues and collaborators at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, Johns Hopkins Medicine, the Armstrong Institute, the Association for Professionals in Infection Control and Epidemiology, the Society for Healthcare Epidemiology of America, the Emergency Nurses Association, the American College of Emergency Physicians, Miami University, and Salesforce, I would like to thank you for your time and enjoy the modules.
This preparedness module focuses on ED leadership actions and planning to occur prior to any patient arrival. This module will be built around dialogue occurring in a planning meeting. An effective and safe response to a suspected or confirmed Ebola patient requires significant and collaborative preparedness planning. This module focuses on planning and actions by an emergency department and other organizational leaders that needs to occur before any patient arrival. This series of modules will cover issues of preparedness planning, such as pre-hospital transport and EMS, patient arrival, the triage process, staffing the patient care team, patient transport from points of entry to the designated treatment area, patient placement, personal protective equipment procedures, laboratory safety, environmental infection control, equipment reprocessing, management of waste, and defining communication protocols within your organization. Addressing these issues and your institution's preparedness planning will require collaborative partnerships from leaders across your organization. CDC provides detailed guidance on preparedness for each of these topics, as well as management of the deceased and special populations. After viewing these modules and seeking additional information on the CDC website and in the CDC guidance documents, it will be important to convene a multidisciplinary team, including physicians, nurses, pharmacy, healthcare administration, facilities, security, communications, laboratory, health safety and environment, and other experts to tailor this guidance to fit your organization's particular circumstances and meet the needs of your staff and patients.
Let's get started. We're here to discuss the hospital's response to Ebola, how we, our staff and our hospital can be prepared. We have several items to cover today. Let me pass out the agenda. First, we'll discuss how we can safely transport a patient under investigation for Ebola.
The arrival of a patient who reports risk factors or symptoms that might be consistent with Ebola can present numerous potential risks. To minimize these risks and help staff feel prepared and remain calm, each institution should develop plans for key issues around patient arrival. First, prepare a plan for how a patient under investigation for Ebola will be transported from the point of entry to the designated Ebola treatment area. Second, develop a plan for managing medical equipment as well as hospital equipment and facilities. For example, if you use a wheelchair to transport a patient with suspected Ebola within your facility, how will that chair be decontaminated? Third, ensure staff understand how to protect others from contaminated fluids, such as vomit or loose stools in public areas, and that all needed supplies are readily accessible. Fourth, decide how the patient care team will be staffed, keeping in mind that the care providers should be fully trained on the procedures and protocols, including the proper and safe use of personal protective equipment.
Next on our agenda is from the emergency department. We'll have a discussion on patient flow and patient placement.
Because of ongoing monitoring of returning travelers by public health authorities, the risk of these patients arriving in emergency departments without warning is low. However, Ebola screening protocols need to be integrated within your ED triage processes. Consider reviewing your ED workflow and triage process to clarify roles and responsibilities that make sense to staff and fit current practices. For example, determine who will be asking which screening questions and if registrars, greeters, or security personnel are expected to ask travel screening and exposure questions. You will also need to collaboratively decide how patient flow and placement within your screening and triage area will work, and how staff will hand patients off to ensure no critical information is lost, and in a way that minimizes risk of exposure to staff and other patients.
Next on our agenda is the discussion about the importance of designating an isolation room within the ED, making sure that the room is properly serviced and maintained, so our colleagues here from facilities and the emergency department could start that discussion.
The management of a patient with suspected Ebola within the physical space of your facility is critical to minimizing risk of infection. Key decisions about patient flow and room management should be decided in advance of patient arrival and in collaboration with nursing, supply management, facilities management, environmental services, and infection prevention. Patient placement is important, and you will need to decide which room will be your isolation room. To decide, you should consider your ED layout, as well as flow of patients, staff, supplies, and waste. You should also clarify a plan for putting the chosen room into service. For example, decide what equipment needs to be removed and what equipment needs to be placed in the room before the patient with suspected Ebola enters. Define your plan to meet room logistics requirements as well. This includes the availability of waste management resources, such as large biohazard bags, cleaning products, and removal of waste. Also, identify the bathroom considerations for the isolation room. If the isolation room does not have a bathroom, ensure that it does have a covered bedside commode.
Next on our agenda, we'd like our infection prevention colleagues and our communication colleagues to have a discussion about the lines of communication and the plans for such.
I'm interested to know exactly who and when will be contacting the local public health authorities.
In critical safety situations, effective communication is essential. To prepare for a patient under investigation for Ebola, you should develop protocols and consistent expectations for how to communicate critical information. Specifically, your institution needs to define internal communication protocols, including an up-to-date contact list of who needs to be informed when the Ebola preparedness plan is activated, when a patient under investigation for Ebola arrives, and how they should be notified. Additionally, your institution needs to define external communication protocols. Specifically, designate who is responsible for contacting the local public health authorities and what information they need to provide these officials. Consider how your facility will communicate with the press and the public. After defining these communication protocols, ensure staff are familiar with them by providing training and job aids, such as scripts and call lists.
Next agenda item is laboratory safety.
Thanks for the opportunity to share with the team. We've been working on safe handling and management protocols. The CDC has some very specific guidelines on how to do this.
The issue of laboratory safety is most relevant to Ebola assessment hospitals, where evaluation of patients under investigation for Ebola will likely include testing laboratory specimens or transporting samples to another laboratory facility for testing. Partnerships between ED leadership, laboratory services, and infection prevention will be necessary to define your institution's protocols and procedures for Ebola testing, as well as other laboratory testing that may be needed during patient evaluation and care. In addition to clarifying where and how Ebola testing will be performed, it is necessary to define how other laboratory tests will be completed for patients under investigation for Ebola when needed. For example, as detailed in the management module, alternative diagnoses should be considered, including other infectious diseases such as influenza or malaria. Each facility should plan for how these tests will be conducted and how the potentially infectious nature of samples will be communicated to internal or external laboratory services.
Next topic on our agenda would be an update from the emergency department and our IP colleagues to give us an update on plans for designating the isolation and controlling access to those isolation areas.
Sure, we've already designated the isolation room, and also I brought some examples of signs that we've developed to control access to that area. We have a stop sign for the patient room door and also the log that we'll be using to have people sign in as they enter and exit the room.
While managing the care of a patient under investigation for Ebola, it is important to be deliberate and efficient. Develop a plan to minimize risks associated with staff going into and out of the patient room. For instance, signage on the door can indicate that no one is to enter the room without obtaining permission at the desk. A sign-in log should be used to identify all personnel entering the room. A key strategy for minimizing risk to staff is to limit the number of individuals who enter the room and develop a plan for clustering care. This means that tasks should be bundled together to minimize the number of trips into and out of the room. Consider communication tools your facility will use to minimize time in the room, such as an intercom or telephone. These tools may also be used to allow the patient to be able to communicate with their family and visitors. Prepare a plan for the possibility of a patient leaving the room when unauthorized to do so, and work in conjunction with your local public health authorities and security personnel on this planning.
Next agenda item will be managing waste. If we could have facilities, EVS, and the emergency room nursing have a discussion about our plans for managing waste.
Facilities has made plans with nursing and EVS for disinfecting and disposing of medical equipment.
Facilities management, environmental services, nursing, and infection prevention leaders need to develop plans for cleaning and decontamination in general areas, as well as patient care areas. This plan should cover how to clean, disinfect, or dispose of all medical equipment. This includes portable items like thermometers and EKG wires, as well as devices that require more than surface decontamination. Both internal and external waste management must be planned. For instance, determine how your facility will manage contaminated waste within the local regulations. Consider whether your facility has the option of autoclaving or incinerating the waste on site, and if the facility has a vendor capable of removing contaminated waste from the institution. Check with your local public health authorities to confirm the procedures and any local requirements for dealing with liquid waste.
Could someone please clarify the difference in PPE for the ED versus the inpatient setting?
That's a great question. Thank you. The CDC guidance outlines two different levels of PPE.
Preparations and planning must address methods for ensuring proper use of personal protective equipment, or PPE. All healthcare workers who have contact with the patient should put on appropriate PPE based on the patient's clinical status. If the patient is exhibiting obvious bleeding, vomiting, diarrhea, or a clinical condition that warrants invasive or aerosol-generating procedures, such as intubation, suctioning, or active resuscitation, PPE designated for the care of hospitalized patients as outlined in CDC guidance should be used. If the patient requires active resuscitation, this should be done in a pre-designated area, using equipment dedicated to the patient. If these signs and symptoms are not present and the patient is clinically stable and under investigation, healthcare workers should at minimum wear fluid-resistant gown, surgical face mask, face shield, and two pairs of gloves. All equipment used in the care of these patients should not be used for the care of other patients until appropriate evaluation and decontamination. These PPE requirements are detailed on the CDC website and in training modules on donning, doffing, and the trained observer. Leadership at each institution needs to ensure that adequate supplies and materials are available and that an ongoing training and competency program for staff is in place.
Next on the agenda is training and education, if we could have a discussion about training and educating our staff.
Sure. We've developed a training and competency plan, and this plan includes the use of super users. And in addition, we're developing a plan for drills and ongoing training and competency.
Define your institution's training plan and consider options for reinforcement of skills and opportunities to practice. For example, in addition to a single training session to build basic competence with donning, doffing, and observing PPE protocols, it is also recommended that facilities use ongoing practice and drills. Each institution should develop a plan for how to reinforce communication protocols, workflows, and other aspects of their Ebola preparedness response. Consider how you will develop local coaches and leaders for other staff in each area, and how local staff will know the chain of command and where to obtain relevant information. These considerations will help form your training and preparedness plan so that staff in your facility can safely and calmly recognize, isolate, and evaluate a patient under investigation for Ebola. Walking through your hospital's specific workflows, protocols, staffing issues, physical space, etc., is a path to the safest preparedness to care for a patient under investigation for Ebola.
Appreciate your time. Thank you.